Hi, I'm Di Heuser from PLR Planners, and welcome to Sue Fleckenstein and mine's Christmas Advent Calendar Surprise Fireside Chat. We wanted to cover a couple of topics, and the way we've had to do it because of internet challenges is we couldn't do it as a full-blown webinar, so we've just recorded our individual answers and questions and then compiled them into a video, so I hope you enjoy it.
Hi, it's Sue from Grateful Journals, and welcome to what I'd like to call my fireside chat with Sue. While Di's over there out in her garden, we're sitting here with at least 6 inches of snow outside. So I just wanted to do a video about who I am and where I came from. I mean, most of you, if you know me already, you know that I have the Grateful Journals store and that I create the planners and journals. But, who am I and how did I get here? This is what I wanted to share with you today. So I love to start telling people that I actually flew 3,000 miles and I married the boy next door, which I actually did, and next year will be 34 years ago. But now looking back, you could just see the things that influenced you to get to this point of where we are today. Things like when I was at school, my two favorite subjects at school were English and geography. I loved the thought of living in another country, and I've always wanted to travel. And I just remember spending so much time just, looking at different countries and how they lived and what the houses looked like and all the beautiful scenery. And, I've been lucky enough to travel after school. Instead of going off to university, I traveled. I ended up living in Munich for a year, and that's absolutely a beautiful, beautiful city. I remember going to the town marketplace and you'd watch the Glockenspiel play. I think it was 11 o'clock every day, and the little figures would come out and do a dance, and it was such a huge tourist attraction, and you never got sick and tired of going there and looking at it. And then going down to the Olympic Stadium on the days when the fern wind blew and you could actually see the Alps, and just standing there looking at that whole line of mountains covered in snow was just absolutely beautiful. I've been to Holland and Belgium and Austria. The only country I never got to go to was Switzerland while I was in Europe, just never made it there. And then, I went back to England, and then I always had that travel bug in me. And then, because my grandfather actually had come from Canada, and I remember hearing stories about how when he was younger, he'd have to climb up the bedroom window on top of all the snow to get to school. So, I decided, what the heck, I'm going to Canada. So I did the nanny thing back then, and we're talking, like I said, over 30 something years ago. It was really popular. And that way too, it was easy for me to go because my mom said, I had a job to go to, I had a house, I had someone to go live with. So, it was from her point of view, it was very easy for me to let me go, kind of thing. And again, looking back, I have to say that I got my entrepreneur spirit, I think, from my mum. She always told me to just go out there and do whatever it was that you wanted to do. She was married and had four kids by the time she was 21. I can't even imagine that. And she always said to me, do what you want to do first, and then you can always do the settle down thing later. And I'm so glad that I, followed her advice. And even, my grandmother was, she had that travel spirit, because going back to now after the First World War, she hadn't got married yet. She was 26 years old. People were starting to wonder if there was something wrong with her because she hadn't gotten married. And she actually had traveled over to France. She was working and living in the south of France. I think she was a governess at that time. And she actually, at one point, worked for Walt Disney. And he had asked her to be the voice of Snow White. I mean, so that's my little claim to fame there. She did turn him down. And sometimes I wonder, because of Snow White, the way she looks and her beautiful long hair, my grandmother looked and had that hair like that. So I just wonder sometimes if he actually even based that character on her. Going forwards, I came to Canada. Yes, and I did marry the boy next door. And, I had my boys. And then too, my boys are actually, they were born 1 year and 4 days apart. So their birthdays are May the 1st and May the 5th. So I didn't even know that I was pregnant with Matthew until I was 5 months actually pregnant. So it was just like a big surprise. And, you know, at the same time, I was thinking about going back to work, so there was no point. And then with two small babies, just trying to pay for daycare, it would be more than half my paycheck every week going on daycare, and it was just like it was just not feasible. So that's pretty much when I started doing my like work from home type of stuff. So my first thing was doing a, I ran a daycare because I'd been a nanny, I'd done all that, so I did a daycare for a while. And then in between there, you know, I've done like everything from selling Tupperware to potty light candles to selling lingerie, selling books online. I used to deliver a magazine to people. They would order from it. Like it was all like kitchen gadgets. They would order from it. I would take the orders and go back and deliver it. That worked really well. But with our Canadian winters, it wasn't the best thing to be doing with two small kids when it's minus 30 degrees outside. But I've always wanted to just, you know, have my own business. And then along came, you know, the internet and the computer. We didn't have one till, well, Mike went to high school, and by then it was like, you know, all the kids are supposed to have a computer. So, and again, you know, talking 30 years ago, they were super expensive. So it's like, we've got to make money with this computer. And then I fell into, you know, I tried a couple of things like affiliate websites. None of that really worked. And because again, going back to my love of English at school, I loved English, and I started doing freelance writing. I was on a site, I think it was called the Wealthy Affiliate, and I saw a job board where people were offering to write articles for people for their affiliate marketing websites. And I thought, well, I can do this. So I started doing that, and pretty much from there, I never really looked back. You know, I put one job posting in, I got so many clients from it. I started up my freelance writing business from there. And then, you know, there was other sites I posted on, I got, and you know, and I met some really great people. Two of the, I guess the most influential people that I met when I was freelancing was Justin Popovich. At that time, he had best quality PLR, I think it's called. He's now Tools for Motivation, is what you might know him as now. So I did a lot of freelance writing for him, and then his friend, Brad Goss, I did a lot of freelance writing for him as well. And you know, and as much as we all love the internet, both of those guys live about an hour away from me. So, you know, I was ended up writing for, you know, fellow Canadians, which is great, of course. And they gave me lots of tips. You know, and then they would just share things with me, like, Sue, you know, you just wrote those articles for me, and I this is what I did. They would tell me what they did. We turned it into a PDF or a lead magnet. And we made all this money, and you know, they'd be telling me, well, you know, I paid you this much, but I just made $3,000. And the other time was somebody, one of them made like $8,000-$9,000. And it's like, geez, what am I doing freelance writing? You know, when there's other ways to make even more money. Because you know, the only holdback with freelance writing is you can only write so much, you only have so many hours in the day, you can only do so much, so you're capping your income. So that's when I discovered the world of PLR, and that was due to Tiffany Dow. I just want to make sure I get her name right. She had come up with this, I can't even remember the name of it anymore. But anyway, it was a course about how to start your own PLR store. So that's what I did. And, you know, I went full swing with it. I got it up, I got it running. And, you know, and again, too, you know, like I you know, Tiffany always said, let once you get things going, let me know. And she was happy to promote us. And of course, you know, you might sell 100 of these, but only 20 people take action. So I was one of those people that took action, and I got some products up for sale, and she promoted me. So that was a way that she helped me to start building my list as well. And then, you know, I just started doing more and more, putting, you know, products on Warrior Plus and JVZoo at that time. And, you know, so I did quite well with the PLR store. Just came to a point where it wasn't fun anymore. And then a lot of people were coming up with all these huge PLR packs that they would sell for $7. And they would have graphics and covers and just so much in there. And, you know, they had a team of people making everything. And I just couldn't compete. There was just, you know, they would put their products on sale and sell 500 copies. And I bought some of them and I would look at them and then they'd be like, oh, the English was terrible. It was just not good quality. And yet there I am knowing my products were good quality. The English was great. And I'd be lucky if I sold 100. So, you know, I got just, you know, disappointed with it all. And I wasn't enjoying writing the articles anymore. And then I just discovered PowerPoint. And what you could do with PowerPoint outside of doing just slides. And I have to give credit to, it was a marketer, her name was Tracy, and she was Irish. And she came out with some products that use PowerPoint, and she was creating magazines. And I just thought it was fantastic. So I started looking into the PowerPoint more. And then, you know, and again, it's something that you have to kind of look outside of the box. Well, okay, PowerPoint is for slides, but what else can we do with it? And I was trying to create some graphics for my PLR store. So the little like storefront graphics. I didn't have Photoshop or anything at that time. And it was like, well, why not use PowerPoint? And all I had to do was make small images. It would just make the slide size smaller. So that's one of the first things I ever created with PowerPoint. And then just from there, it was just, you know, learn how to, you know, to do the journals. I mean, I saw people doing journals and planners, and I thought they're so easy to create, and then you can decorate them with all the graphics. So it was just a matter of just learning how to do them. And, you know, I did start trying to do it in Word, and it was just, oh, it was just so frustrating. You know, because the minute you wanted to change something or add an image, the images didn't always go where you wanted them to go. And that's when, you know, I can do this in PowerPoint. So, you know, you just change again, change a slide into a page. You know, it doesn't have to be a slide. And then that's where I just started with the Create Four journals. And, you know, my very first product on there was the journal prompts. And, you know, at that time, too, I had a chat with Angela Wills, another Canadian, by the way. And, you know, she was just saying, like, you know, just put a product out, because I didn't know what to start with, like a full blown planner or something. And, you know, we were talking about journals, and she said, well, what about just doing some journal prompts? Because people love those. And that's, you know, I have to give her credit for coming up with that, this idea, which I ran with. And my journal prompts is still a really hot seller today. I've had members, I mean, we're going on 3 years now, and I've still got people in that site today. You know, so, and then from there, it was just, you know, if you see some of my first products and you see what I'm putting out now, we all learn and grow as, you know, as we develop things. And, you know, and so that's pretty much, you know, how I got along with things. I've always, you know, wanted to do things differently. I just didn't want to do the mainstream, you know, what you're supposed to kind of do. You know, looking back now, you know, I lost my mum, 25 years ago. But, you know, she was a big influence with things, like I said, just do what you want to do. Go out and do these things. You don't be held back. And, you know, whereas my dad was more of the traditional, you know, you're a, you know, the girl, get up, grow up, get married, and that's it kind of thing. That's what your life is all about. So, you know, so I give a lot of credit to that, to my mom. And this is where I am today. I've got this huge, nice business that just, you know, is still growing every day as long as I keep putting out new products. But that's a little bit more about me, where I came from. And it's just funny, like, you know, lately too, I've been doing a lot of just thinking back, and a lot of it is, you know, I always wanted to travel, and I always loved to write. And it's just funny how those two things have, you know, come kind of full circle to be where I am today. And, you know, my travel got me to Canada, met my husband, and my love of writing has, you know, developed into, you know, a full blown online business that, you know, I'm super happy and proud of having, you know, that I'm so glad that we have right now. So that's a little bit more about me. Anyway, and I hope you enjoyed this conversation. Thanks.
I wanted to give you a bit of history on my life. I'm a single mom with three kids, although they are practically all grown up now, with the exception of my son. And I've been single for probably about 20 odd years now, and it has been quite a challenge over the years to start building an online business. And initially, I started out as a teacher, went to varsity, did a sports degree, came out, lasted exactly 6 months in the teaching industry, and then went into the computer accounting business. And then I started my own business where I was selling and supporting accounting software. And after a couple of years, that crashed and burned, and so I was back to square one. Then I started working for a big corporation as a business analyst and then a project manager, and eventually got retrenched 2 years after my son was born. So it was at that point I decided I was never going to work for anyone else again, although I did at some point go back and work in the corporate industry for exactly 1 year, and again, just realized it was not going to work for me. So in between all of that, I had always loved scrapbooking and I had always loved Photoshop, and I started to learn how to use Photoshop when my dad gave me a copy of Photoshop Elements version 2. And I had the most incredible fun, and then I got mentored by a really good designer in the digital scrapbooking world. Her name is Kim, and she taught me so much, and then I eventually started selling my digital scrapbook designs online in a store in the US. Now, unfortunately, at that time we were still dealing with practically dial-up, where I think I had 20 gigabytes a month that I could work with. And as you know, graphic files are very big. So it was a big problem trying to get data across and getting the graphics uploaded. And we also, at that point, although we had PayPal, we didn't have the facility to bring money into PayPal and then back into a South African account. So we had to have bank transfers done, and it would cost $45 before you'd ever blink. So if you're not making a lot of money, $45 was a huge chunk of money to be paying out. But ultimately, we started to get better and better internet, and one of our banks in South Africa partnered with PayPal, and so we were able to bring money into South Africa. And I think it was at that point that things really started to turn around. But I started out online by finding myself in the Warrior Forum, and I learned an enormous amount there, and I made some really incredible friends. In fact, a lot of the friends that I'm still friends with nowadays all came from the Warrior Forum, including people like Sue and Bill Platt and a whole host of others. So I'm really grateful I ended up there. It taught me a lot. We obviously don't spend much time there anymore since it was sold, because it's a whole different vibe, but Facebook seems to be now the new place where everybody gathers, at least for now. So I started by doing websites for people. I taught myself everything I needed to know, and I really battled. And then when Dr. Manny opened up his Warrior Forum book club, where we were talking about publishing on KDP and Kindle books and that, I was very interested in that. So I started getting involved in that. And then, of course, what happened was the low content book market exploded. Well, it started with the coloring in books, and then it morphed into journals and planners and all sorts of things. And for me, that was just perfect, because it enabled me to use my digital scrapbooking skills and start creating pretty journals and planners. And again, that wasn't great. I mean, it wasn't making me a huge amount of money. But what I did find is that people were asking me, when they'd seen my journals and planners, if there was any way they could buy it and then modify it to use as their own. And it kind of sparked an idea about selling PLR. So in June of 2018, I made a decision that I was going to focus on the PLR side of things, and I did that. And it was from that point on, when I had a single website that I could drive people to, that things literally turned around for my business. So I'm very excited about that, and the potential for this market is still, I believe, quite untapped. I know a lot of people say that KDP is kind of flooded in that, and yes, it is. But it's like that in any industry. You're always going to have competition. The question is, what are you going to do about the competition? How are you going to make yourself stand out from the rest? So that's my basic history. In terms of a personal life, I'm not just designing. I absolutely love and adore my vegetable garden. And particularly with the COVID thing hitting us this year, it made me very aware of how fragile our economy is and how fragile it is for a lot of people. I mean, we were fortunate in that we managed to survive because we had an existing online business. But for those people who were working in the brick and mortar industries that had to close down, it was a major shock. And a lot of people lost a lot of money, lost their incomes, lost their jobs, and in some cases have now started to lose their homes because they could not afford to pay for it. So for me, that was a big wake-up call. One, the vegetable gardening got very serious because I thought, okay, well, at least if I can provide myself with the fruit and vegetables that we need, that will be one way of cutting down costs. And the other aspect is that it kind of got me thinking about how I can help other people. So we started the community initiative in PLR Planners, which enabled people who don't have a wide audience to sell their PLR products through our store. And I'm very pleased to say that that's actually given a lot of people a kickstart. I'm very pleased to see somebody like Carmen Chan, who's really taken that opportunity, built up a huge business for herself. And that's exciting to see that. There's a couple of other people that have done that as well. And I think it's really great because if you can give back to the community, I sincerely believe that there is enough business for everybody. It does not have to be a competition. And I've always believed in this community and cooperative kind of approach. So that's my basic background and what I get up to, apart from the fact that I have a bad habit of rescuing dogs. I now have 5 rescue dogs and 5 rescue cats. So that might be a bit, I think I've reached my limit. I think my landlord might have a little bit of a hissy fit if I get any more. But also it's not practical to bring in any more. So that's it in a nutshell. Thank you.
Okay, so next up, let's talk about the tools that we use. And pretty much, Di, I think we both use almost the same tools for a lot of the things. I think the autoresponder is a little different. If I'm correct, you use Aweber and I use ConvertKit. Anyway, so let's just do a rundown of the tools that we're using and why we're using them. Of course, you know, WordPress would be, you know, what I run my site on. It was just the easiest way to get a nice customized theme on there. And with all the plugins, it's easy to use, easy to customize. So basically, you know, that's what we use for that. And then I use Amember is the shopping cart. And before, you know, we go any further, you know, it's best to mention that no one tool is going to be the best. And especially when it comes to shopping carts, I found that no one shopping cart has everything that you want. So you just kind of have to pick the best one that suits your purposes at the time. You know, I like Amember. Before I started with Amember, I actually used Easy Digital Downloads, which is still around. I loved that shopping cart. The only thing it didn't have was an affiliate program. So when I tried to integrate it with a couple of different affiliate programs, it just never worked. So I just gave up with it. The reason I went with Amember, because at that time, you know, I was just starting my PLR store, and you know, you always have in your mind, well, I want this person to promote me and I'd like that person to promote me. They were always raving about Amember, how they like to use it as an affiliate as well as, you know, to sell their products. So basically that's why I went with it. And because it's everything, it's got my shopping cart there, it's got the affiliate program in there. And one thing I do really like about it is that it's the PHP script. So it's separate from WordPress. Like from a customer point of view, when they're in the members area, they're on WordPress, or that's what it looks like. But you know, from the vendor's side, my WordPress site is different and my PHP site is different. So if something happens to WordPress, my Amember can still be running. And if it ever happened that WordPress got hacked, they can't get into Amember. Amember support it's very good. If anyone's thinking about getting Amember, just have to keep in mind that The A member people are in Eastern Europe. So sometimes when you explain something to them, they don't always get exactly what you mean. So if it's something more difficult, I would just say send them a video of the issue that you're having. It's probably the easiest way around everything. But once they're on your case, they're really helpful. They get things sorted out for you. And I've noticed lately that they have been answering tickets on a weekend, as I think more and more people are using a member. They do install it for you, which is another plus, and then you just have to, learn how to set it up and get the products in there. As an affiliate, I like it because I have one account to log in. So if I'm in PLR Planners and I've purchased some products, I can go download my products, but then I can just click the affiliate link tab and I've got all my links there and the links are ready to go. There's none of this having to generate a link or I have to go find the page on the person's website, copy the page, put it into the affiliate program to generate my own link. I try to make it easy for affiliates. So, that's, and as an affiliate, I like that. It's there, it's easy to for me to find my links, everything's in one place. And it's fairly easy to use. And again, if you do, if anyone's out there is thinking of getting it, there's a great A member Facebook group that you can join and get help with. And there's some really knowledgeable people in there. So, if you do, let us know and we'll give you the link to that Facebook group as well. The next, well, obviously, I use PowerPoint. So, I've got the Office 365 subscription. So, I always have the updated version of PowerPoint. And that, without PowerPoint, my business wouldn't be there. So, that's one tool that, it's worth paying for. I started off paying monthly, and then I think after so many months, they'll come and offer you a great deal if you switch to a yearly one, which I did. So, to me, it's worth that payment. I think it's under $10 a month. If you're just starting out, and there is an online version, but it doesn't have all the capability of the Office 365. And then you'll get the updates. The Office version has a few more features, like if we're doing the outlines and you've got the sketched lines, that's not available in the regular Microsoft PowerPoint, only in the Office 365. So that to me is, is well worth the payment for that each month or each year. Then on top of that, I've started to use Canva for mainly for my store images, and because I'm working with the VA, like I now have the team helping me. So with Canva, I can either sometimes put my own like little layout there, and my VA could go in and fine-tune it. Or actually, she's really good at doing the store graphics, so she can create them, and she just shares me the Canva file, so we can go back and forth with Canva, which is really nice as well. So I have started to use that more and more in my business as well. And yeah, I mean, and I do use Photoshop, which Di has been giving me great tips because it's not a tool that I'm that familiar with. But I can create some covers, and I'm learning the digital papers. And it's one of those tools. It's not as intimidating as it seems when you first open it up. So if you have a need for it, it is well worth it. And then the other tool that I really like is my Adobe DC, the pro version. So I know I just pay for that, the bundle of products again from Adobe, because it's cheaper than just getting one-on-one. And they'll have sales and discounts for you as well, so you can find not a bad price for that. I like the Adobe Pro because I can create the editable PDFs with the fillable forms. You can go in and just rearrange pages, delete pages, duplicate pages. I can take a PDF and switch it from, save it as PowerPoint, or if I need it in Microsoft, a doc, I can change it over as well. So there are some of the features of that, and that's why, again, it is a paid tool, but to me, it's worth it. There are many. I think it's more PDF and some other ones out there that are very similar with the functions. But I just, for my purposes, I've had the Adobe Piece Pro now for a while, so I've just kept that one. And what else do I use? Oh, ConvertKit. So for my email, my autoresponder, I hook it up with ConvertKit. I did have a Weber. I changed a few years ago just because at that time, I have no idea what it's like now with AWeber, but when I had AWeber, I had to pay, you pay per subscriber with AWeber at the time. So if I had 1,000 people on my list, but 500 were on more than one list, I'm actually paying for 1,500 customers or subscribers a month. Whereas with ConvertKit, I can have one customer on 20 lists, but I'm paying for one customer. So that was one of the reasons why I switched over. And the other reason with ConvertKit is that you can tag people, put them into segments, put them into different lists, which I find useful. So I can just track how many people have purchased what product. If I want to email people that have just purchased a certain product, I can do that with ConvertKit. I can actually also do that inside of a member as well, which is another nice feature of a member. And then I can set the broadcasts to go with ConvertKit. They now have a feature where an offer actually that you can just you can join for free and get 1,000 subscribers for free. So again, if you're starting out and want to set up start with a free tool to start with, then you can get your 1,000 subscribers for free. And again, with the autoresponder, it's something that is, don't look for free options. Take the paid one because you don't want to get banned because you sent out an affiliate link or something. Spend the money, and once you get going, if you're paying $20 a month, you'll easily make that money back. So it's definitely worth, if I had to tell you to pick one tool right now, I would pick a paid autoresponder if that's all that you could afford. So you can get affiliate marketing going, you can create your mailing lists for your products and things like that. So don't skip on the autoresponder is not what I'm trying to say here. Other tools, yeah, I mean, I have a few other things that I use, like on the WordPress, I actually pay now for a it's like a backup service, well, a support service. So it's called FixRunner. They go in every month, they update everything for me. If I ever get any glitches, they're there within 5 minutes. They're looking at my site to figure out if there's a plugin conflict or if I were to get hacked, they would be right there on it for me. So that's something I've just started paying for in the last 6 months or so. Yeah, I mean, and it's worth it. The other week we had a critical plugin update, and it was instead of me having to stop what I was doing, I just sent them an email and they went in and fixed it within, 5, 10 minutes. They're really good in that way too. So that's basically, I think that's all the tools that I use. I'm just trying to think if there's anything else. But they're the main ones, so it would be the WordPress, a member, of course, PowerPoint, Photoshop, ConvertKit. And then I've just started, like I said, to use Canva a bit more as well. So basically, I think that's it. So if you have any questions, just let us know. Thanks.
In this section, I want to talk about some of the tools that I use. So when I first started with the PLR planners and that, I was using initially Word and Photoshop, and then Sue introduced me to the power of PowerPoint, and I just got really excited because it was just so much easier to drag and drop in PowerPoint, and you could design any way you like. So we started doing most of our PLR products in PowerPoint, and that was all thanks to Sue. And one of the reasons why we chose PowerPoint was the fact that most people seem to have it. And if you don't have PowerPoint, you can still use something like Google Slides or Keynote if you're on a Mac. So most people can get away with not having to pay for any software and design journals and planners and printables using those kind of slide tools. And of course, over the years, they have got more and more sophisticated and have almost become graphic design programs in their own right, with some limitations, of course. Now, I still use Photoshop for my actual designing of graphics and that, because I prefer the advanced functionality that you've got and the multiple layers that you can do and the different kind of effects that you can achieve with Photoshop. When I first started, as I mentioned before, I started with Photoshop Elements 2 doing digital scrapbook kits, and the skills that Kim taught me were invaluable in transferring across to the low content industry. I would recommend, if you have the time or the resources, to invest in a proper graphic design program because it will just elevate your product to a higher level. You know, there's people I know that have recently started using the Affinity Publisher, which my daughter brought out a training course on, and I haven't got sunk my teeth into Affinity Publisher yet. But what I particularly loved about the Affinity Publisher in terms of the functionality was that you could set up master slides or master images that would then transfer down to the individual pages, and it looks like a page. It almost looks like PowerPoint in that it's got the different pages down the side, and you can modify the master page and then it'll all ripple down to the individual pages. And that's particularly powerful when you're doing things like hyperlinks for the digital planners. The other tools that I use in terms of design, I've played around with Canva. I'm not really fond of it, and I don't like the fact that it's all sitting on a third-party platform. And that always makes me very uncomfortable, in that you could lose it very quickly. I've never really used InDesign, although I know a few people that are using it and they create some really beautiful stuff with it. My suggestion is that it is worth investing some time and money into a proper graphics program and getting to know how to use it properly. You will find that it speeds up your production a lot more. So, in particular with Photoshop, because I spent so many years working with it, I discovered workarounds using data sets and things and actions that really do speed up your production, and it makes it very easy to create multiple journals or a multiple page journal within a few minutes just using the tools that these kind of graphic programs have. Now, in terms of other tools I use a flipbook maker called HTML Pub 5, which enables people to see what's inside the book. So you would just upload a PDF and then people can flip through the book and see what's inside it. And that's particularly important when you're trying to convince people to buy an intangible product online. In terms of activity books, I use quite a few puzzle makers that various people have brought out, and I cover that in my Activity Books Treasure Map training program. So those are the basic few tools that I use on a consistent basis in my business.
So challenges that we faced, okay, that's a tough one. I'd have to say, like, one of the biggest challenges is just believing in yourself and just knowing that you can go out there and get something done and having the confidence to just go ahead and do it. So I think one of the biggest things is, yeah, just, you know, having confidence, get out there and get it done. It was scary. I know when I switched from the PLR store to the journal store, it's like, is this going to work? And, you know, you're just so nervous about it, but it was just like, okay, go out there, treat it like a brand new business. And I did. I bought a brand new install of a member and I set it up, you know, right from day one, I set it up properly instead of just, I'm just going to test it out and put it on, you know, a WordPress site or use a PayPal button instead of like, no, let's do this full blown and go for it. So that was a challenge, and just believing in what you can do. And then, you know, the challenges is just knowing that what you're putting out there is good quality, keep on creating content. And then you worry about, you know, other people. When I first started with the PowerPoint and the journals, I was pretty much one of the first people to use that method to create the journals and planners. Other people were still doing it in Word. And I think, Di, when I first met you, you were still doing it in Word. And that actually was a great pairing because you had Word versions and I had PowerPoint versions. So that really, you know, was a great match at first. And then we just, you know, both decided, you know, PowerPoint is the way to go. It was so easy for people to used to create the journal, so we both switched to PowerPoint. And then that brings you to, you know, a challenge of not being scared to connect with other creators. I mean, you know, instead of you and I thinking, oh, we're competitors and we can't work together, we thought the other way. And yes, you know what, we can do projects together, we can brainstorm together, we can, you know, knock ideas off for each other and stuff like that. So, you know, so that challenge of thinking that you can't talk to another person that creates journals because there's competition and stuff like that is crazy. So don't even think that that is a challenge for you at all. And then it's just, yeah, it's hard to think. What else would be the challenge? Just, making the time to work on your business, as everybody says, treat it like a business, which I totally agree. So the other challenge would be not to get distracted, which is so easy to do. I mean, even now, it's so easy to get sidetracked. So it's like just stay on focus and challenge yourself to, put out one journal a week or one journal 2 weeks or even once a month, whatever that you can manage with. Don't challenge yourself to put out too much content. Just pace yourself nicely so that you can do it nicely. You want to put out good quality products. And even if you're not creating products to sell, but you're putting them on Amazon or your Etsy store, just challenge yourself to just have a nice, easy schedule that's going to fit your family life, for sure. Because I mean, that's another challenge too, is you have a family, whether it's a husband, kids, pets. You have to, meld everything together in with your business because you are working from home, and it's so easy to spend way too much time sitting on the computer and not spending time with, your husband or your kids and things like that. So, so balancing your family life with your business life, that can be a challenge sometimes. And, now I'm at the point where, there's some days where, oh, okay, I got to get working early because, especially if you're in that creative mood. I've got this great idea for a product and I want to just get it on paper kind of thing. And luckily for me, my husband's very understanding in that way and very supportive. So that isn't really a problem. And again, having the support from a family member can be a challenge if they're not on board with you. And I know at first too, it was hard because especially when you're not making that income. It's like, okay, just we've got to make money from the computer. I remember that when we first had the computer. Okay, so you make some money from the computer, and it's like, okay, I'm trying this, I'm trying that, I'm trying this, and then yes, you're spending hours and hours trying things, and then once you found something that worked, it's great. And now, pretty much because my husband's retired, our roles are reversed. So I'm the one's working, and he does 96, 97% of all the cooking and everything else around the house. So we just switch roles kind of thing. So I mean, that's another thing that can be challenging. And then there's just things like the tech issues. Oh, sometimes they are challenging, but that's when you use the support. Like, now I don't think now if I have an issue with a member, if I can't figure it out quite quickly, I send in a support ticket. I don't waste my time doing it. So don't let the challenge of tech get you down. If you have the support person there, if it's a hosting issue, get on your hosting company, get them to help you. Get on WordPress. That's why I have the fixed runner for WordPress. They can fix anything that goes wrong when it does happen. I don't have to spend, 4 hours in a day trying to fix a WordPress or trying to find which plugin didn't update properly. I'm at that position now where I have someone to do that. But yes, it takes time to get there. And and remember too, like if you are thinking of doing a store, and like don't let what you see me and I doing now put you off, because we had to start somewhere and we struggled and we had to work hard and we tried lots of different things. It takes time to get there. So, if you're not going to build a store, like we have in a month. It's crazy. So you can look at what we're doing and think that's where I want to end up. But remember, it takes time to get there. So don't have that challenge of, oh, well, they're already, they're selling hundreds of products and I can only sell two. Like we've had our times where we've only sold a couple of products, believe me. So that's, another challenge there as well. I mean, I think really, it's more like I said, I think if I had to bring it down to one big challenge, it would be just the mindset of knowing that you can do this when you put your mind to it. Make sure you schedule your time in, have your business time or your business hours, have your family hours, and it will eventually all work out together. And yeah, just reach out. If you're stuck with an A member, go to the A member Facebook group and ask for help. Ask me, ask Di. Even we ask each other for help. How many times? Or I'm stuck with this. Or this won't work. Is something acting up for you? So don't feel like you're in anything alone. There's people out there to help you, and just don't let the challenge of running a business get you down. Because once you get it going, and if you work on it hard, put the time and effort into it, you are going to be rewarded with a great business. Right. So anyway, hope that helps. Thanks.
In this segment, I'm going to talk about some of the challenges that I've gone through in the last 2 years. When I first started the online business, of course, I had no money, and it was very difficult to try and build an online business without capital. So a lot of the times I had to bootstrap this business, and also because I didn't have money, I had to learn how to do a lot of the things myself. And I'm deeply grateful for that because it gave me an overall understanding of what's needed, and it kind of made me a jack of all trades, which is potentially not a good thing, but it does give me enough knowledge to know how certain things need to be done, and then you can hand it over to an expert when you have the financial resources. So for me, it was a case of battling day in and day out to make sure that we had enough money to feed the kids. And that's quite soul destroying, because often what happens is you're so focused on trying to survive that you don't think in terms of the bigger picture of your business. And unfortunately, I think that's why a lot of small businesses fail in the beginning, because one, we're trying to do it all ourselves. Two, there just isn't enough time in the day. And three, if you're dependent on the business just to survive, you kind of start thinking short-term money instead of long-term growth and development of the business. But being as it is, a lot of people have to start like that. And the upside to that is that you do learn some skills along the way. Some of the other challenges that I've faced is a lack of self-esteem. I think everybody goes through this. There's always going to be people who know more than you, and that's absolutely great because you can learn from them. But often what happens is you let it stop you because you think, well, somebody else has done it already. The question you need to ask yourself is, what is your unique perspective that you can bring to a particular problem or challenge, and that somebody would be able to relate to better than they say could relate to me as an example? And I think getting to grips with the fact that you're going to have to put yourself out there, particularly with an online business, you're going to have to start making videos and doing recordings and training videos if that's the area that you're going to be moving into. And it's very difficult to do that, particularly if you're not one of these model-looking individuals. I've watched YouTube and see these beautiful women doing these incredibly great videos and thinking, well, I look like a dog. And I'm not trying to be self-deprecating here. I just know that I'm not photogenic. And so it gives me a bit of a complex. And I think once you get over that and realize that most people actually don't even notice it, you are the only one who notices it or thinks about it, you kind of get over yourself. And I think that's a big challenge for yourself, is to get over yourself and actually just get up there and start talking and recording and practicing. And as you do it, you get better and better. And something else that I've found is that I've stopped recording for a while. I have to rebuild my self-confidence up because I haven't done it for a while. So it becomes like exercise. If you stop doing it, your skills start to atrophy and your self-confidence starts to drop. So that's the one of the challenges. The other challenge is thinking of to the future. What is going to happen to the market? What are you going to be doing in the future that will ensure that your business continues to survive with or without you? Have you thought about what happens? Do you want to build a business that somebody else can take over, or do you just want to have enough money for the time when you retire? And the problem is that with most of my target market, we are already at that stage where we're pretty close to retirement. And so what are we doing about the future? And I think what has to happen is you need to start, take a walk, get away from your business, get away from your PC, and take a walk and spend some time thinking about what it is that you'd actually like to achieve. Because we often get bowed down by fear and pressure because we're not performing as the way we think we should at a particular time. And I think that one of the challenges you've got to realize is that setting anything up online or any business does take time. And what are the activities that you are doing that will actually help you achieve it? So in the beginning, the challenge that I faced is that I was all over the place. I wasn't focusing on one particular thing. I was trying to build websites. I was trying to write books. I was trying to do digital scrapbook design. And I was trying to do low content books. And unfortunately, if you spread yourself that thin as one person, you're just not going to be able to make it. So my recommendation is to pick one thing that you're particularly good at and just focus on that until you're really good at it and that it's making you a decent amount of money. Another challenge that I faced is that I would spend too much time working. You really need to stop working for a stage and go and take some time out and do some gardening or reading or exercise or spending time with friends and family just to give your mind a break, because you can suffer from burnout, and that of course impacts your business. Another challenge I face is being too concerned what other people think about me and my business. And it's only as I've got older and wiser that I realize it actually doesn't matter what anybody else thinks of your business. If somebody doesn't like your business model or your business products, then that's fine. Let them go and shop from someone else. There's enough business out there for everybody. But I hope that's helped you a little bit, just to give you a brief overview of some of the challenges I've gone through and how I've dealt with them.
Okay, so let's talk next about the importance of affiliates. I know we both love our affiliates, and you know, basically our businesses would not exist unless we have affiliates. You know, I see lots of people worry about, you know, having affiliates on board, worried about paying them the 50% or whatever percentage that you set. But you know, it's without them, they expand your reach to a whole different market of people, and you know, they're reaching people that you don't know. So you know, when you say, you know, you think, oh my goodness, I've just paid that affiliate $100 or more, well, you've just made that $100 or more for yourself as well. So you know, you're still making money. Yes, you're paying them out, but at the same time, you know, when they see the sales, they're going to keep on promoting you all the time, and it's going to keep generating you the income. So, you know, it's definitely worth having a good affiliate program. I mentioned that before in one of the other videos about making sure that, you know, when you have an affiliate program, that it's easy for affiliates to use, make it easy for them to sign up. I've signed up for a couple in the last few months, people wanted me to promote them, and either I couldn't get through the sign up process because of things like you're not in the US, so they didn't want you to join, or a few of them have set these limits. I mean, it's one thing I just can't stand is when they say you don't pay out commissions until you've, you know, met the threshold of $100 or something. I won't sign up. So make sure that, you know, you don't have anything like that in your affiliate program. You, whether they make $5 or $500 a week or a month, however often that you pay, make sure that you pay them. So you want it easy for them to sign up and easy for them to find their links. Again, don't make them use some URL generator and they have to go find, you know, we have to go find the sales page first, and then I have to go and log back into the affiliate center, and then I've got to go find the generator to get my link, because unless your product makes me thousands of dollars, we're just not going to bother. To be brutally honest, if you make it too hard for an affiliate to find their link, they will not promote you properly. So make sure that it's very easy, and there's more than a member out there. I know a couple of other marketers, they use I believe it's called WP affiliate, so yeah, I think it's called that, I'm not quite sure, but anyway, that's not a bad affiliate. I don't think it's expensive as a member, but then, you know, you've got to make sure that you're running something like WooCommerce as opposed to the A member shopping cart. So there's lots of different options for affiliate programs. iDev is another affiliate program that I looked at. I really did like it, but at the time I was using the Easy Digital Downloads, and it just was not integrating properly. And and I just liked, like I said, the one platform, shopping cart and affiliate program all in one. And then make sure that when you do get affiliates signed up, I have a little like a getting started guide that I send out to affiliates so they know what products, how to find the links, how to add an affiliate bonus, which of my products sell good, which are my training courses. So make it easy for them to know what they can promote. Offer them coupons. Like, don't be scared of offering people coupons, especially to new affiliates. Let them get, their customers, let them get to know your products. So you want to use coupons. You could make them a landing page. So you want to work with your affiliates. That's what I'm trying to get across. So, if you've got an affiliate that really does well for you, offer them a coupon. Anytime. I've given lots of, they have evergreen coupons, a lot of my affiliates, so they can use them on whatever product they like, when they like. They don't even have to ask me. Just here's the discount, give it out whenever you feel like it. So you want to do things like that because we're all reaching new customers. If they want something like a custom landing page just for their customers, create one. It's easy to duplicate a page inside of WordPress. It's easy to duplicate a product if you're using a member. So you can customize things for affiliates as needed. So, I really want to, stress the point of, kind of bend backwards for your affiliates to give them what they want when they need it, and make time for them if they're having an issue. I know one time I was having an issue getting a link from someone else's site, and they helped me do it. It's not just, oh well, I don't know why. They looked into it and they got me the link, so as an affiliate, I appreciate that type of thing as well. And then, the last thing I really want to just say about affiliates is, you're always looking for new affiliates, so don't be scared to connect with people that you would like to be an affiliate. So if you're starting out, you're creating a new store, and you think, oh, I would love Dai or Sue to, promote one of my products. Well, reach out to us because we don't know you're out there unless you connect with us, whether it's on email, on Facebook, Skype. Find us, send us a message, let us know what you're up to, and then also send us a well, first, ask us if we'd like to look at a file, and then send us your product. Like, no one's going to. I see so many people that won't send. I'll just send you 2 pages. So send me the whole thing. I can look at it, and I can see if it's going to fit my list. And at the other time, I'm more than happy to give you a little, sense of a little bit of help. Well, maybe if you tweak this, it would be better. Or, like, not to, give a lot of criticism, but if I see something that, well, if you just did this one tweak, the whole product would be fantastic. I'll let you know. And this way too, I can go through the product, and then when I write my emails for my affiliates, I can, tell them more about it rather than I haven't seen this. I always like it when, yes, I've had a review copy. I've been in the product. I've seen it. I've opened it. Things work. Not, I think one poor lady, she bought the PowerPoint files that wouldn't open, or they wouldn't convert for some reason, and she could never get help from the vendor. So, and that's another thing too, with when you have the affiliates and one of their customers have signed up and they're having an issue, you now do the customer service. So you want to make sure that your customer service is there for affiliates and customers at the same time. Because it's all part of your business, not just making the sales. We want to do the after sale work with customers, with our affiliates too, so make it a complete business and a business that people want to keep buying your products from. I mean, I love it when I get the emails from customers that say, Sue, when's your next product coming out? I've got everything in your store. I need something new. It's like, I love that. So you just want to, so whether it's affiliates or customers, the customer service is important. Reach out for, if you're looking for affiliates, reach out. Don't be scared to reach out to, like I said, myself or Dai or Maureen or Ruth or Nirjan or whoever creates products that are similar to yours and you think would be a good match. Reach out and let us know, because yes, we do get lots of people ask, but we're looking for the quality products, and I'm looking for people that if I promote you, I don't just want to do it one time and then you don't put out a product for 6 months. So let me know that, you know what, I've got this product coming out in 2 weeks, I have another one. And then I, you know, because I'd rather be, I like to promote the same people over and over again, as long as it all converts for me as well. So basically, yeah, I think that's about it for the affiliates. I mean, just don't be scared to have an affiliate program. You know, you're paying them, but at the same time, whatever, if you send out commissions for $1,000, it means you've just put $1,000 in your bank account that they helped you generate. So this is where you want to think about, you know, the affiliates, not that, oh my goodness, I'm giving away half my money to them, because you're not. You wouldn't have earned that money unless they mailed for you. So, you know, work with your affiliates, give out coupons, and just be grateful when you get people, or thankful that people sign up to your affiliate program, and just make sure it's easy to get the links. And work with everybody. That's about it.
In this segment, I want to talk about the importance of affiliates. Now, for those of you who don't know, affiliates are people who will help you promote your product in exchange for a percentage of the sale. And generally speaking, in our industry, it's 50%. Some people give less, and that's fine. You know, it's entirely up to you as an individual what percentage you want to offer affiliates. So when you're first starting out with a low content book business, let's say you're doing PLR as an example, or whatever business you're doing, you might not have a very big following or a big email list. And the important thing is to find people that you trust, that you can do business with, and then offer them an incentive to promote your products by giving them a percentage of the sale. So the challenge comes in when you first get started. You probably have no people, and then you'll get some affiliates who will promote for you, and so you'll start building up your email list. And here's where a lot of the people and vendors make a big mistake. They think now that they've got this list of people that they've got from other people, they can now start ignoring their affiliates. And I think you need to realize something very importantly. It's a small industry, and word gets around. So if you come onto the market and you build a great big business using other people's customers, and then when you launch a new product and you don't let your affiliates promote it first, it's going to give you a bad reputation and people will stop promoting you. So you need to make a decision. Either you use affiliates or you don't. But the bottom line for you in any business, and I believe this very firmly, is that affiliates are in fact an asset. They are not an expense. If you had to look at how quickly your business grew with affiliates and compared to without affiliates, it's absolutely worth giving that percentage of your revenue to them. So I want to encourage you very strongly to treat your affiliates with respect and dignity, because there is nothing worse as an affiliate to come in and help somebody do really well with their product, and then 2 months later down the line, they release a new product and they don't even let their affiliates promote it until after they've emailed their list. So what I do with my list is I don't even mail sometimes until after a day or two, but I give my affiliates the opportunity to mail first so that they can make the money. Now, how you decide to run your business is your business, but just bear in mind that affiliates will probably help you build your business, and as such, you need to treat them with respect. When getting affiliates to promote for you, try and make it as easy as possible for them. So most times we set up a JV document depending on the actual product. If it's a standard product through PLR planners, we tend to just give them some brief information like what the plan is about, what kind of assets the customers get and things like that. But if it's a bigger product, I would recommend putting together a JV document where you give the affiliate all the information they need, the links that they would need to use, and potential graphics that they could use, as well as putting together a few email swipes. In other words, you write their email for them. And most people prefer to do their own email swipes, but sometimes, and even I get too busy, and will actually use a product vendor's email swipes simply because I just don't have the time to come up with my own. And as time goes by, you will build a really loyal base of affiliates. Those affiliates that consistently promote for you and support your products, treat them like gold. Give them extra, perhaps a commission bump, or give them extra resources to help them get started, or give them a heads up a few weeks before everyone else as to what you're planning so that they can plan their bonuses and their promotion schedules around all of that. So bottom line is, If you're going to use affiliates, then remember that they are an asset and not an expense, and you need to treat them like any other asset in your business very carefully. But I hope that's helped.
So next up is ideas. So where do we get our ideas and how do we come up with all the products that we put into our stores? So, you know, at one point, it's easy to get ideas at a point, and then you always get to that point where, oh my goodness, I'm stuck for ideas. So, you know, where do we get our ideas from? Lately, my last set of ideas I got from doing a customer poll. So that's one idea. So you create a customer poll using Google Forms or any of those type of tools. And if you have a customer list already, you can just ask them, you know, what niches they're looking for, what products they're looking for, what, you know, get feedback from them. So that's a great idea generator once you have a list in place of customers that you can ask. Before then, when I first started out, you know, I looked at, you know, I obviously you just do a general Google search for journals and planners to see what type of planners are out there, what type of journals are out there. And that would give you the basics. I think that's where, you know, part of the journal prompts came from too, because a lot of people, you know, that just regular journal people need the prompt ideas to write in their daily journal. And then from there, you know, it's just more research. You go to Amazon and look at all the books, especially, you know, like go into the journals and planners and see what kind of, you know, topics are there, see what the best sellers are, just to get ideas. Do use the look inside feature to see, you know, what you can see. Obviously, you're not going to copy anything, but you're just trying to generate some ideas. And I just like to keep a notepad. Either you can do a notepad, or if you use Trello, I know I have a Trello board going too with ideas. So you can just put down, you know, like a Bible study journal, a daily planner, you know, things like that. So whatever you know, whatever ideas, just jot them down on, you know, on somewhere. If it's an Excel spreadsheet, if you use Evernote, you know, just create yourself a file with ideas. And then what I do is when you see something that you really, really like, I'll just copy the URL and I'll save that too. And again, we're not copying, we're just trying to generate our own ideas. So, you know, if I want to do a Bible journal, for instance, I would just go and start searching out, you know, the layouts and the colors and I look for things like, are they all floral? Are they abstract designs? So you can kind of see what, you know, what's selling out there. So you have an idea of which way to go. And of course it never hurts, you know, you want to be different anyway. You want to put your own spin on everything. So Amazon is another good idea, a place to research ideas. And then there's Pinterest. You know, you can get so many ideas from there as well, what's selling. And then when you're doing the search on Pinterest, if you look at the top, you know, as you put in a certain type of planner, it will give you other suggestions in there. So that's things too that you just may not even think of. You know, so a yearly planner can come out with all kinds of different yearly planners, whether they're niched ideas or just general ideas. So Pinterest is an absolutely great place. Etsy is also another great place, because, you know, if you're selling on Etsy as well and you want to see what other people are selling there. And again, it's just to get ideas. Look at some of the top stores, the ones that are selling, like, you know, a lot of products, and see what type of products are there. And again, just to generate ideas. And then I just make notes of, you know, colors. Is a health planner, are they usually pink? Are they blue? Are they mixed colors? Are they, you know, certain layouts you could get an idea for. And then it's just, you know, you come back to the drawing board and then you just start putting things together. And again, like I said, we can't copy, but you're just trying to generate some different ideas. And where else do we get ideas from? Just general research, the Google, Pinterest, Etsy, Amazon. And then, you know, like I said, customers. I mean, I've had a lot of my customers just ask me. I think that's where my grandma and me templates came from, where somebody had asked me, had I thought about doing a set of that, and it's like, oh, you know, instead of just the pregnancy one, let's do something on the grandparent side. So that was a great idea. My herbal one was an idea actually from my lady that helps me with customer service. So I want to give her the credit. She came up with that idea and she put the layouts together for me. So, you know, so it's letting other people, you know, if you're lucky enough to have a team, or you will when you get to that point, you know, sometimes they have suggestions as well. And just be open to taking people's suggestions. I mean, and then research them. Like, I don't do everything that someone asks me. I'll go and research it and see, are the similar things selling? So if it would be, you know, worth putting together a product. And then just, you know, and then try and put your spin on things. So while we're creating journals of planners, this is where my simple templates came from, because, you know, they're not full blown. They're just like page inserts. So that was an idea that I just came up with, because, you know, I'm thinking too, if I buy one of my planners, how do I customize this? Because, I mean, sometimes they're just so nice the way they are that you don't want to touch them, but you need to. You need to make some changes. And that's why I thought, well, we could add extra pages in. So this is, that's how I got the idea for all my simple templates, was, you know, as pages that people can insert into it as well. The same with the pretty printables. It was just, okay, we don't have to do full blown. Let's break it down into smaller packages. Let's create printables. Printables are easy for people to create. They're obviously cheaper because they're not so labor intensive. So I can sell them at a cheaper price on my site, which is great for customers. And then, you know, there's the whole printable market too. So that brings you to like trends as well. So you want to see what's trending out there, what people are buying. Like now, you know, is all the digital stuff. So digital journals and planners, and even again, the simple templates, we can turn those into digital inserts. You know, so that's, again, it's easy to put a spin on something. So that's why I would say to you, like, look for ideas where you can put a spin on things. And make it your own. You know, you want to have a style in the end, so that when people open up one of your planners, when it's been on the hard drive for 6 months, they can say, oh, I know this came from Sue, or oh, this came from Di, or whoever. You know, that's when you know you've created that style. And you know, to me too, that's part of the ideas, is creating your style and your brand that people recognize as well. Yeah, so I mean, ideas are everywhere. One time I got an idea after TV news. There was a product on the TV, or I think that was for my PLR store. It was a fitness over 50, or some kind of thing there. And that turned into a full-blown product. And actually, that was one that I ended up selling to somebody because they wanted to own the rights to it. So the TV magazines, when you're in the grocery store, look at the magazine, see what are the headlines on those front covers, to see what's going on. And then there are lots of research sites that you can use as well to get ideas. Looking and Facebook groups as well, see what people are talking about. I mean, I join a lot of planner and journal Facebook groups just to see what people are talking about. And as well as just ideas for creation, it's also ideas of how we can help our customers. What issues are they having using a planner? Like, is there, and that's where my PowerPoint course came from, because people were, I don't know how to do this and I don't know how to do that. So instead of me doing customer service all day, helping people, it was okay, let's put a course together. And then it's all self-guided, go in there and look at the videos. You know, so they're like the spin-off ideas that you can think of creating for yourself as well. So it's just basically ideas are everywhere. Just keep your eyes and ears open. And when you find an idea, make sure you've got something to write it down on, whether it's on your phone, a piece of paper, a notebook in the car, whatever. Just make a note, because the time you get home, that idea might be gone. So that's what I would suggest. So anyway, they're pretty much all the places that I get my ideas from. Let's see what Di has to say.
So where do I get my product ideas from? Well, there's a couple of channels that I use. The first thing I did is I ran a survey for my customers, asking them what sort of products they would like, and I got a wealth of information from that. So I would recommend one, running a survey with your existing customers to find out what sort of journals and planners and printables that they're looking for. You know, once people tell you what it is that they want, you will find that you will have a far higher success rate when you release something. So that is something really worth considering. Always listen to your customer. Your customer is telling you all the time what they want. The question is, are you actually listening? Another source is I actually go and spend some time on Amazon itself, and I have a look at some of the best-selling books and planners and things like that. And then I go and read the reviews. I also read the bad reviews, because often what the bad reviews tell you is what's potentially missing from that book. So let's say you have a health and fitness journal that's doing very well. Most people will love it, and that's great, because that's the whole purpose of it. But there are a few people that might say, you know, it's missing X, Y, and Z. And it's in those reviews where you say, but it's missing this, or if we could have had more of these type of pages and things like that, that you will get ideas that will help you generate product that actually fulfills a specific need. And remember, the thing is not to cater to everybody, to cater to a niche. So if you're looking at health journals as an example, go and have a look at a specific age group and see what they're saying about that particular planner or journal. Another place that I spend time at is Pinterest. Pinterest is great just for visual ideas, and it's also really pretty stuff. So it's quite soothing to the soul to go and have a look at some beautiful graphics and images, and have a look at what people are oohing and aahing about. Look at the number of likes and loves and hearts that they're getting. Look at the comments that they're getting. Instagram is another source that you can go and have a look at. And I would recommend that you spend at least 2 hours a week minimum just doing research on those social media platforms. Another place that I spend a fair amount of time on is YouTube, not just looking at the low content book industry, but looking at other business models and seeing how people are doing things in there. And that often sparks an idea that's completely unrelated. And that's one of the reasons how we came up with the digital planner training. You know, taking our existing business model and expanding it into a new market. Sean Hansen's new training that focuses on Zinnia is another example. Again, taking our existing skills and products and just expanding them and modifying them for a completely different market. I also spend a lot of time reading business books, and I mean a fair amount of time reading business books. It's most of the reading that I do. I very seldom read a novel. The reason being is that by reading business books on how other people have set up successful businesses completely unrelated to what I'm doing, is again, it gives you an idea of the systems and processes that they've put in place that enable them to be successful, and then how do you implement a similar concept in your business. So, and that often sparks ideas. Just a simple thing like a system and process manual could be something that's very useful for a company or a small business. There's a product idea. You could put together a small manual that will allow people to document their systems and processes so that if anything ever happens to them, somebody could come in and take over the running of their business. Another example is, what happens to you if you become ill? You know, who will make sure that all your stuff is still running smoothly? If you're loading product onto Amazon, who's making sure that those books are all loaded properly? Things like that. You know, you just need to consistently look outside your industry for some new ideas and look at what other people are doing and then say, okay, well, how could I adapt that to my business or to a product? So those are just a few of the ideas. You know, there's a million different ways of getting ideas. Talk to people. Go and have a look at Facebook groups and see what people are saying. Have a look at what adverts are being run and how popular they are. And you'll start getting some new product ideas. And also the idea is not to copy them, but just to get inspiration so that you can then put your own spin on certain stuff and make it unique to yourself.
So going forward with my business, where do I want to be next year? What do I want to do next year? I think one of the things as a business owner is we always have to be on the lookout for how we can grow our business, where we want it to go, what direction do we want it to go in, the type of products, can we add different products to the store, should we add more training products, like that type of thing. So for myself, what I'm thinking, you know, for next year, like, because 2020 was one year that we'll never forget. You know, everybody has been stuck at home, so it's definitely, you know, And I know there's so many people that want to open up their own PLR stores, or they want to get their Etsy store going. So for me personally, I mean, I'm on the lookout for some different kinds of products. I have some ideas of some new training things to put into the store. Like I mentioned before, I've done a customer poll and I got a ton of feedback from there that's given me lots of ideas. So I have to go and see which ideas are feasible, which ones that I can use. And it's just, so product wise, yes, I want to put different products in. I think I'm going to do some more training products because I'm enjoying creating the training for everybody. Teach people, how to do PowerPoint. Do I want to look into Canva more? Things like that. As much as I love PowerPoint, there are some restrictions in it that you can only do so much. It isn't a graphics program. So yeah, it's just trying to think of, where I want to go. I'm still trying to, I've been jotting down ideas of where I want to go. So one thing that I do want to do for next year is I want to grow my Etsy store, and that's more of a, like, it hooks in with personal life too, because like we're getting older, my husband is retired, and if this pandemic hadn't have happened, we had some travel plans. So we're going to go down south. We were going to do the Canadian snowbird thing this winter and go down south for maybe 2 months. Obviously, we're not crossing any borders right now. So I'm trying to think of what I can do in my business, what else I can create, so that when we do get to the point of we can start traveling again or doing some more of the things that we had planned, I can still have a business, I can still have money coming in, but I still have the time to do the other things. So that's where I'm really trying to, move forward into. So this, if I can get a good Etsy store going, can I get lots of sales going on there? And that would give me a nice chunk of income. So would I put less products in the journal store? I'm not sure, but at least I'd have an additional stream of income. So it's not that you want to close anything down, but it's just if I can have two incomes instead of one, and then maybe one will sustain me over the summer when we travel, and then I work on one more in the winter time. Like, I mean, I've just got so many different things going through my head right now that I don't even know exactly where I want to go. So it's always hard to say that, but I mean, plan wise, yes, it's put more stuff into the grateful journals. It's do the training products, get into doing videos more. So that's another big thing. And again, it comes back to, as we talked about before, looking at the trends, what people are using. And because we always want to be out there reaching for new customers. So it's like, where do we find our customers? So that's part of going forwards too, is trying to find where we can find new customers from. I actually got approved into this big Christmas promotion for a lady in the UK that's a big blogger, and her market is coaches and a whole different, stream of people that, they're looking for content for to because they're a coach. So there, I'm really interested to see how many people sign up for my gift in that one, and see if that's another like avenue for me to explore. And a lot of it too is just exploring ideas, exploring opportunities when they come up, and seeing if it takes you somewhere. I think I should get into, maybe the digital products a bit more. I did start doing them. Again, it's just balancing the time with everything to get them created and see if it's, is that something that's going to sell on the store? I've put things on the store that, as a test, and some sell really well, and then some just don't do as what I thought. So obviously, the demand isn't there for them. So so it's basically just wanted to just, keep up the ideas, obviously keep working on the business, trying to make, time for family, especially we're headed into the Canadian winter, so we're going to be stuck inside quite a lot. So I can do a lot of work, but come the summer again, you want to take time off. So that's what I kind of want to do. Hopefully, once you can travel again, I'd love to be able to travel and see some places. We had, now the boys are growing up and left home, we have the time to do it. Now we just can't because of the situation. So, personal wise, yeah, I'm working on health, working on losing some pounds. I did really well, and then I kind of got off track in the summer, so I have to get back onto that. Yeah, just I've been reading a lot of books on nutrition, so it's a personal goal. That's one of that I want to, because like you said, we're all getting older, and you have to take care of what we have already. So what else? Geez. Yeah, it's just finding that nice balance between work and family, looking after your health, looking after yourself, taking care of, your family, running a good business, and getting everything done. So I definitely have to use my own planner more next year so that I can keep on track with things. I do in the tax, and so that's not like I haven't done them in 4 months and I've got to catch up with everything. Like, I don't like doing that, so I want to be able to have, be on track with things. So that's one of my goals for next year too, is just to get a bit more organized, especially with the back end of the business, the finance stuff, because that's what I take care of. I don't have anyone to do that for me. So getting more organized next year, and just find, hopefully, I don't know if we can find that nice balance between business and family, because there's always things that come up, but I do my best to do that. So anyway, but don't worry, there will be lots of new products coming into the store, new training products as well, and I know Di's got some good training products up his sleeves too.
Going forward, I have some very big plans for this business, both on the commercial use side and the personal use side. I'm in the fortunate position that I've now got my daughter Simone working for me, and so she's taken over a lot of the administration and mundane tasks that take up a lot of time, like loading products, zipping up files, creating previews and things like that. Now, it depends on your business goals and how it is that you want to set up your business going forward. For me, it's really important that I actually have something concrete that I can leave to my kids that they can continue with after I'm gone. That is my primary aim. So it's not just about financial security for myself, but it's ensuring that my children have a solid business foundation, first of all, and secondly, that they have some viable assets that they can run with in the future. So what I've been looking at in the near future is I'm looking at ways that I can expand my personal use market, and I'm looking at a lot of different types of products that we can create. And then secondly, looking at how I can help other people do what I'm doing. So I will be releasing a very big training course at the end of January called Sell the Shovel, which is exactly that, is teaching you how to set up commercial use sites that will enable you to help other people with ready-made resources. In the future, I'm going to be doing less and less of the actual design work, as much as I love the design work, because I find that my time is better spent doing research and then coming up with ideas and concepts and putting together the training. So my primary focus next year is going to be training courses while Simone and my designers work on the actual products themselves, like planners and templates and printables and things like that. All in all, my goal is, I don't think I'll ever really want to retire, but I do want to spend more time researching how it is that I can help other people achieve financial stability, how it is that I can help other people build a business with limited resources. Because I mean, that's the biggest challenge we all face at the moment, is that not everybody has the resources they need to build a solid business, to have somebody helping them. And the more we can outsource or JV with, the better your businesses will become. And so that is my goal for the next, for 2021, is to really set up some tools and systems that will help you as an individual either build your business to a sort of a small sized company with several people working for you, or to allow you to become more efficient as a single operator and enable you to use your time more productively. Right, that's it, and thank you for joining us on this fireside chat. I hope you got value out of it, and be sure to let us know if you've got any questions. Thank you.